turn, if you would, in your Bibles to the book of Romans, and we're in chapter 15, Romans chapter number 15, and our text this morning is from verse 14 down to verse number 21. Romans 15, and we'll be reading from verse 14. I myself also am persuaded of you, my brethren, that you also are full of goodness, filled with all knowledge, able also to admonish one another. Nevertheless, brethren, I've written the more boldly unto you in some sort, as putting you in mind, because of the grace that is given to me of God, that I should be the minister of Jesus Christ to the Gentiles, ministering the gospel of God, that the offering up of the Gentiles might be acceptable, being sanctified by the Holy Ghost. Therefore, whereof I may glory through Jesus Christ in those things which pertain to God, for I will not dare to speak of any of those things which Christ hath not wrought by me, to make the Gentiles obedient by word and deed, through mighty signs and wonders by the power of the Spirit of God, so that from Jerusalem and round about I have fully preached the gospel of Christ. Yea, so I have strived to preach the gospel, not where Christ was named, lest I should build upon another man's foundation. But as it is written, to whom he was not spoken of, they shall see, and they that have not heard shall understand. Let us pray. Our Father, we're thankful that we can gather together in your house. We're thankful for the fellowship of the saints. Thank you that we can sing these songs of praise to your wonderful name. And we thank the Lord for the public reading of the Word of God. We pray now that you bless us as we take the time to look into the Word of God. I pray that you speak to us and challenge us and accomplish your will in our hearts and lives today. For we ask these things in the precious name of Jesus, our Saviour. Amen. I want to speak to you this morning in our text this morning about the subject of the ministry of the gospel. The ministry of the gospel. I enjoy reading the writings of Paul because, well, for many reasons, I guess, but for one of the things is every now and then you get a snapshot into the life and ministry of Paul. And we've seen this a couple of times with the book of Romans, where he kind of pulls back the curtain of his personal life as a minister of the gospel, and he helps us to understand the way that he thought. He helps us understand what his motive and his method in the ministry was. And so as a minister of the gospel, I find that greatly interesting and encouraging, and I'm sure you find it too, because at the end of the day, each one of us are ministered together with God. It doesn't matter if you're a preacher or whether you're a Sunday school teacher or whether you've never taught a class. All of us are involved in the ministry in one way or another. And we can be encouraged by looking at the Apostle Paul and the way that he ministered. One of the things about ministering the word is that it is a multifaceted ministry. Because on any given Sunday, I will be speaking to a group of people such as yourselves that may have, maybe coming to church today with a whole host of different difficulties. So there may be some here today who are struggling in some area of their personal walk with the Lord. Maybe there's a spiritual problem. Or there may be someone else who has the burdens of this life, the cares of this life. Perhaps there's just financial difficulties weighing down upon them, and these things perhaps are on your mind this morning. Or it could be that you have health problems and these things at the forefront of your thoughts. Or you could be going through a time of family difficulties. So you could be anywhere and any one of those things this morning, and you come to the house of God and you need something from the Word of God. And of course, to be able to minister each and every one is going to be an impossibility, humanly speaking. But the Bible is such a wonderful book because it is the Word of God. And the Word of God gives us just what we need when we need it. And so I'm mindful of the fact that the Bible says that all scripture is given by inspiration of God. Now, that's a tremendous truth, that the Bible is a God-breathed book. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. So that puts us in a very strong position this morning, because we hold up in our hands the Word of God. This is the very God-breathed Bible. And we know that being the Word of God, He's going to give to us just what we need. Wherever we are, whatever we're going through, He knows that. He'll give to us what we need. And so that verse says, it goes on to say, all scripture is given by inspiration of God, and He's profitable. All scripture is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. The Word of God is going to give us just what we need. And I wonder if you've ever felt like this, that perhaps I've preached a message or dealt with a subject and you think, well, who's been speaking to the pastor about me? Because it's just like, you know, this has been tailor-made for what I'm going through. And to be sure, I think all of us have felt like this at one time or another. I felt like this as a young believer. I'd listen to the pastor preach, and I think, man, has he been speaking to my friends? Has he been speaking to my family? Because he's mentioning things, he's speaking about things that only they otherwise would know. But the fact is, he was just faithfully ministering the Word of God. And the Word of God, you know, doesn't the Bible say that the Word of God is quick, it's alive, and it's powerful, it tells us that in Hebrews there, it tells us that the Word of God is like a sword. It's a double-edged sword, and it pierces to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, of the joints and marrow. It's a discerner of the thoughts and intents of our heart. It kind of cuts coming and going, and the Word of God does that for us. And so sometimes we come under the ministry of the Word of God, and you think to yourself, well, is the pastor speaking to me? No, actually, it's the Word of God that's speaking to you, and the Word of God is showing you and giving to you just what we need. And so as we come to our text this morning, Paul speaks about the ministry of the gospel. And he speaks about a few things about the ministry of the gospel that are indeed multifaceted in the ministry. And the first thing that I would draw to your attention as we look at our text, as we think about the ministry of the gospel, is that the ministry involves encouragement. If you look at verse 14 and 15, Paul says, I myself am persuaded of you, my brethren, that ye also are full of goodness, filled with all knowledge, able also to admonish one another. Nevertheless, brethren, I have written the more boldly unto you in some sort, as putting you in mind, because of the grace that is given to me of God. Now, Paul, in these couple of verses, he begins by encouraging these believers at Rome. And the first thing that he does as he seeks to encourage them is he is very much aware of the fact that they've been saved. He's aware of Christ being in their lives. So in other words, he's persuaded of their faith. And he knows that they love the Lord and that they are serving the Lord. And so Paul is encouraging them. He's seeking to encourage them to continue with their service of the Lord. Now you think about this word encouragement. You know, encouragement has the idea of building somebody up. It has the idea of helping you in your Christian life. Now, strictly speaking, when it comes to the matter of faith, encouragement really has to do with believers. Because if someone's not been saved, have never been born into the family of God, they can't rightly be encouraged in the Christian faith, can they? But if you've been saved this morning, if you're a part of the family of God, you can be built up. You can be encouraged to do something for God. And then another aspect of encouragement is not just a matter of being saved, but a willingness to hear. Because it's very difficult to encourage somebody that will not hear. But if you have a willingness to learn and a willingness to serve, then you are an easily encourageable saint. And so Paul writes to these believers, and he's able to encourage them because of their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And then the second thing is aware of, not just aware of their salvation or Christ within them, but he's aware of their Christian character. Because he uses this word, he uses it twice in verse 14. He says, you are full of goodness. And then he says, you are filled with all knowledge, able to admonish one another. So he's talking about a church that is essentially thriving in the things of God. They had received salvation. They were a church that was growing. They were a church that really was being used of God. And their faith had kind of reached the place where not only where Paul was able to encourage them, but whereby they were actually at a place where they could admonish one another. Now that word admonish is kind of similar to encouragement, but it's a bit more of a sharper word. So the word of admonish speaks about even rebuking somebody or reprimanding somebody. So it's quite a sharp word. But these believers had so grown, had been so, you know, faithful in their walk with the Lord, that they were able to even admonish another believer in the church. They could, you know, issue a word of rebuke or reprimand to try and encourage that person to walk closer with the Lord. But in verse 15, he expresses a bit of Christian concern. Because he says, nevertheless, brethren, I have written the more boldly unto you in some part, as putting you in mind, because of the grace that is given to me of God. So Paul, as he writes to them, he realizes that some people in the church might have thought that he's been a bit harsh at times. Maybe they thought, you know, Paul can be quite a critical individual, very quick to rebuke sometimes even. But what Paul wanted to do is he wanted them to understand why he did what he did in the ministry. He wanted them to have an understanding of his love and of his devotion to them. So when Paul spoke to the church at Rome, and there was a sharp word of rebuke, or perhaps there was a word where he would deal quite firmly about their sinfulness, or perhaps the way that they've dealt with, as we just looked at in the last few weeks, with the weaker brother. And perhaps his words might have been perceived by some to be somewhat sharp. And so Paul seemed to be somewhat unkind. I don't like the way he said that. I don't appreciate his spirit in the way that he wrote those things. Sometimes you might feel like that. You might think to yourself, you know, the pastor was quite unkind today. I don't like what he said. I don't like the way he said it. And in fact, I don't like the fact that he was probably speaking to me in it all. You know, I think we all sometimes feel like that. But the fact of the matter is, and I can speak from my own heart enough, but I will just mention with Paul, anything that Paul said, and I believe that everything that Paul did was quite simply so that the church could be encouraged, so that the church could grow, so that the church could be and do all that God wanted it to do and to be. It was never a matter of like a flash of anger. It was never a matter of, I'm going to get this off my chest. It was a matter of, I'm going to say this, even because it's difficult, because they need it. I'm doing it for your good. That's essentially what he was saying. And I feel the same way within the ministry. I really cannot think of a time where I say something purely to vent or to because I'm angry about something. Anything I say or anything that I do really has your highest good at heart. And the things that I want to see within the church and within your life as believers is to be able to grow and to be what God wants you to be as believers. And so, I think with Paul, and this is where you and I should just consider this now, where Paul ministered to the church at Rome, and where he would sometimes be sharp and where he sometimes would have a word of rebuke, everything that he did was having their best interest at heart. And you know, to be a good servant of Christ and to be a faithful minister in the gospel, every one of us will have a similar viewpoint. We won't be thinking about, how does this affect me? How does this make me feel? What would I like to? It's not about us. First and foremost, it's always about the Lord. What would the Lord want? How does this please the Lord? That must always be our objective. But when it regards our fellow brothers and sisters in the church, we should be thinking about others. The ministry is about others. It's not about ourselves. In fact, when you've been placed in a situation when you can serve the Lord, you need to serve in such a way where it's not about you at all, but everything that you do is about others. You know, when Jesus died upon the cross and Pilate put the inscription above his head upon the cross, and the inscription was something that was quite true. The Jews didn't like to see it, and the inscription was quite simply that this was the King of the Jews. But you know, if Pilate had just wrote others on top of the head of our Savior, others, that would have been equally true, wouldn't it? Because when Jesus died upon the cross, it was about others. It was about you and I. His whole life was one that was about others. The Bible says of Jesus that the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister and to give his life a ransom for many. Now you think about this, that this is God in the flesh, but he didn't come to be waited upon, he came to serve. And you see many a time where he would serve in the most menial type of ways, but he would serve others. And that's how you and I should see ourselves in the ministry of the gospel as well. How we can serve others. In Galatians chapter 5 and verse 13, Paul says, brethren, you've not been called unto liberty. He says, you have been, I beg your pardon, called unto liberty, but he says, only use not liberty for occasion to the flesh. He's saying, don't use liberty, your freedom, for yourself. He's saying, use it, he says, but by love, serve one another. It's about others. And a similar thing is said in 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 5. The Bible says that we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. So when you think about the ministry, there's a great privilege in that we are serving others. It's about others. Oftentimes, this world looks upon those that would serve in the ministry as people that have perhaps climbed a ladder, and now they've kind of reached a place. But the fact of the matter is that within the work of God, the way up is always down. And if you would be great, then you must serve. Just imagine, and just picture, if you would, how our Lord Jesus Christ would put that towel around his waist and take the sandals of the dirty feet of his disciples and wash it their feet. Lowly service. And so we should recognize that our service is one of just that. It's service. And when you think about ministry, ministry is about service. And so the ministry is going to be, the ministry of the gospel is about encouraging one another and how we can serve one another. And then the second thing, and this kind of leads on in the what I've just been speaking about in verse 16, the ministry also involves ministry. The ministry involves ministering. Verse 16. He says, that I should be the minister of Jesus Christ to the Gentiles, ministering the gospel of God, that the offering up of the Gentiles might be acceptable, being sanctified by the Holy Ghost. So Paul, along with being someone that was an encourager or an exhorter, he was someone that served as a minister. His life was about ministry. And Paul had been chosen by God. God had saved him, and God had called him, and had sent him out to be a minister to the Gentiles. And Paul's privilege is similar to ours. He would go out and he would preach that when Jesus Christ died upon the cross, he died for the sins of the whole world. And when he said it was finished, the way to God had been completed. And he preached about how Christ was buried and how he rose again the third day. When Christ was preached by Paul, it was a tremendous privilege. And you and I this morning have the same privilege. We're able to present the gospel to a lost and dying world. Now, you know, Paul was oftentimes called upon to engage upon many different activities, but first and foremost, his job was about getting the gospel to those that were lost. And he enjoyed that privilege of sharing the gospel. And he wanted to reach the Gentiles. He wanted to see those that were perhaps by birth and by sin, alienated from God. He wanted to reach these Gentiles and see them brought into a right relationship with God. And then lastly this morning in verse 17 through to the verse 21, the ministry involves preaching. It involves preaching. Paul's passion was to preach the gospel. I think you're not going to be long in our church where you recognize that there is a great emphasis placed upon the preaching of the Word of God. We love to sing songs, and we love to be able to fellowship, and we love reading the Word of God, but the important thing is that of the preaching of the Word of God. Ministry involves preaching. And so he says in verse 17, he speaks about certain joys that he had, because he says, excuse me, he says, I therefore whereof I may glory through Jesus Christ in those things which pertain to God. Now, he's essentially saying, I've got something to have a lot of joy about. He's saying, I've got a lot of pain, I've endured a lot of adversity in the gospel, but I have a lot of joy. And he's not speaking from a sense of arrogance in any way. He's talking about the joy that he has because when he preaches the gospel and a sinner hears the gospel and trusts Jesus Christ to save them, they're birthed into the family of God and they pass from death to life. They're on their way to heaven. And Paul says this is something that gives him a great deal of joy. I think that one of the greatest joys that you and I can have as believers is not just sharing our faith, but having that privilege of leading a lost soul to the Lord Jesus Christ. It is a tremendous joy that it gives us. And with the Apostle Paul, he recognized that this was something that gave him a great deal of personal joy. Then I'd like you to notice in verse 18, he speaks about the Lord of the ministry. He says in verse 18, I will not dare to speak of any of those things which Christ hath not wrought by me to make the Gentiles obedient by word and deed. This verse essentially Paul is saying, everything that I do and all that I do is all for the Lord Jesus Christ. He's saying, the Lord has worked in my life and has wrought great and mighty things through my life. Paul had experienced some great things, and he had been used in a tremendous way to be able to share the gospel and to preach the gospel all over the world, and to see many souls saved, to see many churches established was something that was of a great joy to him. But he didn't go about life saying, look at these people that are saved and look what I've done. Look at these churches I've established. Look what I've done here. With Paul, it was all about the Lord. Look how God used me. And that's a correct attitude to have. When he preached the gospel, and I believe he was a great preacher of the gospel, he wasn't saying, look at me. He was saying, look at Jesus. Because he knew that if people looked at Paul, they would still stay lost. But if they looked to Jesus, they would be saved. And so he would speak about the Lord in the ministry. And then in verse 19, I like you to notice the power in the ministry. He says, through mighty signs and wonders, by the power of the Spirit of God, so that from Jerusalem and round about unto Illyricum, I'm pronouncing it incorrectly again, I guess, I fully preach the gospel of Christ. Paul wanted people to realize that as he preached the gospel, there was a dependency upon God's Holy Spirit to equip him and to guide him and to enable him to preach the message. And as he would boast, he wouldn't boast in himself, but he would most definitely boast in the Lord Jesus Christ. Everything that he did, everything that he accomplished, he did by the power of God's Holy Spirit upon his life. And so he had a total dependence upon Christ and upon his Spirit. We notice that he says he preached the gospel from Jerusalem throughout the world unto, and I'm going to try and pronounce it again, Illyricum. That's a Roman name for you, but that would be, it used to be known as Yugoslavia. That name has changed now to Serbia and something else, and that's just slightly above Greece. But this is the kind of extent that he had in the ministry, to preach all the way from Jerusalem, all the way down to nearby in Greece. It was a tremendous ministry that he had. But his ministry involved the matter of preaching the gospel. And wherever he went, whether he was on a boat, or whether he was by the seaside, whether he was in a jail, or standing in a courtroom, he was preaching the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, Paul said this in verse 17 and 18. He said that Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be made of none effect. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. The ministry involved preaching, and the preaching centered upon Jesus, and centered upon what Christ has done for us at Calvary. And he was able to hold Christ high and point lost sinners to him so that they could be saved. And he goes on to say in verse 20 and 21 of our text, he says, I have strived to preach the gospel, not where Christ was named, lest I should build upon another man's foundation, but as it is written, to whom he was not spoken of, they shall see, and they that have not heard shall understand. His desire was to go to places and to meet people who had never heard about the gospel, never heard about the Lord Jesus Christ, and he would faithfully preach the gospel to those people. He was essentially a missionary at heart, and he would go wherever the gospel would take him so that the lost could be saved. That was the work of the ministry in the gospel. And every one of us this morning, we're involved in this great ministry. So we should see that the ministry of the gospel involves encouraging. We should be a source of encouragement one to another. It involves ministering to others. It's not about ourselves, it must be about others. And it's going to involve preaching, telling people about the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. So may the Lord encourage us this morning that we together might see that we're a part of this ministry. This is not just something that we attend once in a week. This is something that we're vitally part of. Each one of us a part of the ministry. And we need to encourage one another. We need to recognize the ministries about each other and the ministries about preaching the gospel to those that are lost. I pray that God would encourage us this morning to be faithful in that ministry that God's called us to minister in. This morning, maybe you've never been saved. Maybe you've never been born again. And so the first step for you is not a matter of seeking a ministry, but it's seeking the Lord. Looking to the Lord Jesus Christ and asking him to save your soul. That's where your journey with the Lord would begin. But may the Lord just have his way and lead and direct each one of us by his Spirit today. Let's pray. We're thankful, Father, for our time together in your word, and we just pray now, Lord, that you'd encourage us, help us to be a good and faithful servant of thine, help us, Lord, to be good ministers of the gospel. And we thank you, Lord, that we're workers together with you, and I pray, Lord, that you'd help us to have a dependency upon you in all that we do. I pray, Father, if there's any here today who have never trusted Christ to save them, I pray, Lord, that today they would come to faith in Christ. Father, I just ask that you would have your hand upon each one of us now, for we ask it in Jesus' precious name. Our final song this morning is hymn number 438, Jesus Saves.